Okay, let's take the idea of the CLT, the simple limit theorem, and let's now apply this to sample distribution, the sample proportion. These are two big areas that we've been working with a lot, the sample means and the sample proportion. Now, the CLT also applies to the sample distribution of the sample proportion. The CLT once again tells us that for large enough n sample size, the distribution of sample proportion will be, it will follow this, p hat, the sample proportion will be normal, or the mean, the mu for p hat, is actually pi, the true proportion. And the variance is a little bit tricky. The variance is pi times 1 minus pi divided by n. So one nice thing when dealing with the proportions, if you know pi and you know n, then you know the mean and the variance. Whereas working with the mean, you have to know the mean mu, you have to know the variance sigma squared, and you have to know n. Because the variance sigma squared for p hat is actually a function of pi and n, simply knowing pi and n gives it to me. Now, the requirements for applying the CLT to the sample distribution for the sample proportions is different from the sample mean. Remember, for the sample mean, for x bar, all we needed was n to be at least 30. And then, another thing we could have, if we didn't have a larger sample size, if we knew the population was normal, then we said, well, x bar is automatically going to be normal. But this idea of the population being normal does not translate to the population proportions. The idea of a population being normal has absolutely no meaning when we're talking about proportions. And why is that so? Well, what is a proportion? It's like a bunch of yeses and nos, or ones and zeros. The condition exists or it didn't exist. What you're looking for was there or it wasn't. How can yeses and nos be normal? The measurement scale for proportions is nominal. They're just labels. And then based on those labels, we actually calculate the proportion that we observed happen. Whereas when we're talking about averages, we need at least interval. If we're talking about survival times, that's time. Those are numbers. Those are real numbers, actual numbers that have numerical values. So the meaning large enough n also differs here. For the mean, this is for the mean, we needed n to be at least 30. Well, that's not so here for the proportions. There's three conditions that need to be met for the proportions. Now, having said that, for my class, these two are the only that are important. I don't consider n to be at least 20 to be important at all. Some people do think this is very important. I don't. For my class, you can pretend like that doesn't exist. These are the only two that you really need. If your professor wants you to address n as at least 20, you better check with him or her and do it. I'm not saying this is wrong. I'm just saying, in my perspective, I don't believe this is at all important. If these two are satisfied, this will fall into place. And I'll do a little thing here to justify my thinking on this in just a minute. So what you need to do is take the sample size times pi, and that has to be at least 5. Take the sample size times 1 minus pi, that also has to be at least 5. If you have these satisfied, then you can apply the central limit theorem and say that p hat is reasonably distributed normal with a mean equal to pi and a variance equal to pi 1 minus pi divided by n. Now, let me justify just quickly here my thought process for n at least 20 not being important. Proportions are on 0 to 1. And obviously 0.5 is smack down the middle. Now, if you have a sample proportion of 0.5, then if you look at the distribution of the probabilities, they tend to look like this. right down the middle. And it looks reasonably bell-shaped. But what happens, let me eliminate that and start a fresh layer here. What happens if the proportion pi is very small? Let's say it's over here someplace. Well, now if I look at the distribution of probabilities, it's going to look something like this. See, there's no place to go on the left, so the tendency is going to be skewed right. It's the exact same thing up here. If the proportion is very big, close to 1, we tend to see this exact same sort of thing. It's going to be skewed left. Well, that's not normal. But what happens? If n times pi is at least 5, what that means is n is big enough, hence a proxy for this thing right here, n is big enough such that if I am really close to one of these n's, say over here, n is big enough that the variance pi 1 minus pi over n, this becomes small enough that even though I'm really close to 0, I will get something that looks reasonably normal because the variability is small enough, it's more compact. It's like the discussion on the difference between the distribution of x and distribution of x bar. As n gets bigger, the variability gets smaller, so the curve got more and more peaked. And the exact same thing happens up here. If this isn't satisfied, then n's not big enough. So this actually, in my opinion, in my experience, this actually takes care of that issue. But again, check with your professor. If you're not in my class, find out what your professor thinks, because he or she may think this is very important. And I'm not saying they're wrong. I'm just saying I don't see it as being very important, so I don't require that from my students. So what we've actually been talking about here is addressing the assumptions. If I'm going to calculate a probability for a proportion, my assumption is that p hat is distributed normal. So the big question is, how do I show that's a reasonable thing to assume? Well, the only way to do it with proportions is to apply CLT. So you need n times pi to be at least 5, and you need n times 1 minus pi to be at least 5. Now you can't say this. You have to actually show what n is, show what pi is, actually do the math, and show that it really is greater than 5. If you simply regurgitate this, then that tells me you didn't check, so you don't know if the central limit theorem applies or not. Likewise, when we're talking about the mean, you need to show, the assumption first is x bar is distributed normal, and that's reasonable because of one of a couple of things. Number one, the CLT applies, which you would show. Or number two, we know x is distributed normal. So if you're talking about the mean, you have to specify this is the assumption. This is how you know that assumption is actually reasonable. Again, if we're talking about proportions, this is the assumption. And this is how we know the assumption is reasonable.